Why are the 2022 Winter Olympics so controversial? Beijing is readying to welcome athletes from around the world to compete in 109 events across 15 sports, and become the first city to have hosted both the Summer and Winter Olympic Games. But COVID-19, diplomatic boycotts, and privacy concerns are overshadowing the Olympic spirit of these Beijing Games. In recent months, a global surge in COVID-19 cases has raised fears of a COVID outbreak within China. In an effort to stave off a mass outbreak prior to the Games, under its zero COVID policy, China has locked down major cities, like Xi'an and Anyang, after detecting a spike in COVID cases. To help us understand this and the other concerns around the Winter Olympics, I spoke with Nick Schifrin, the NewsHour's foreign affairs and defense correspondent.
So China has what they call a zero COVID policy, which basically means no community spread allowed at all. So we've seen cities where there have been literally a handful of positive cases, leading authorities to lock down millions of people. At one point, just a few weeks ago, 20 million people across the country were locked down on, again, the basis of just a few positive cases. And a lockdown really does mean a lockdown. Nobody can leave their apartments or their homes. They say it's saving lives, but critics say it's overly authoritarian and restricting people's freedoms, and also leading to unnecessary deaths.
And these tight restrictions extend to the thousands of athletes, coaches, and media traveling to Beijing.
Now, the policy is what they call a closed loop. Basically, anyone coming into the Olympics quarantines themselves inside a kind of giant bubble. It's the largest quarantine in some ways that the world has seen in a couple years, as measured by the number of people entering it.
That closed loop policy is designed to keep the Olympic guests fully isolated from the Chinese population, from airport shuttles to ambulances.
The idea of no spread is something that Beijing wants to keep, not only as a way to keep people safe, but also to prove its own capacity, to prove its own model of governance as it moves forward, despite Omicron spreading throughout the world.
This, as the US, UK, Australia, and Canada are not sending diplomatic delegations to the Olympic Games over the treatment of the Muslim Uighur population in China.
You see the United States, you see the United Kingdom, Canada, Australia, saying that they will not send any diplomats, any representatives of the government to the games. Athletes, of course, are allowed. On the other side, though, South Korea, France, very specifically declined to participate in any kind of boycott and will send some diplomats there. And also, we have not seen any majority Muslim countries from Turkey to Pakistan to Saudi Arabia to Indonesia boycott these games. And that is remarkable, according to human rights advocates, because the victims of China's crackdown in the western area of Xinjiang have largely been Muslims, where Muslim Uyghurs, more than a million, according to the U.S., have been detained, have been jailed, have been forced to work, and forced to renounce their religion and culture and language.
But the 1980 Moscow Olympics, this is not. That year, China joined the U.S. and more than 60 other countries to not send diplomatic delegations or athletes in protest of the 1979 Soviet invasion of Afghanistan.
This boycott is not expected to have any kind of major influence on Chinese policies, frankly, to have any influence on U.S. or allied partners' policies toward Beijing. But China has long cared about international opinion. China has long wanted its major events, like the Olympics, to represent a kind of affirmation of its importance. And so the China scholars that I talk to about the Olympics say that, yes, despite Beijing's claims, this does bother them.
And athletes have their own concerns, too, over Chinese censorship and tracking.
Chinese authorities have required athletes to upload their health data, and often those athletes will do that on the app, My2022, it's called. Independent researchers say that it's full of holes, it's easily hackable, and that athletes' data that is uploaded onto that app can be downloaded by Chinese authorities. Team USA, for example, has advised its athletes to bring burner phones to China because, in general, China is known for stealing individuals' data off of their phones.
On top of digital surveillance, athletes are being cautioned over criticizing the Chinese government.
human rights advocates are saying to athletes, look, you should not criticize Chinese human rights practices while you're in the country. And in fact, Beijing authorities warned that athletes could be punished, in their words, if they broke Chinese law, which has been used in the past to detain critics of the Chinese government.
Even with these concerns, the 2022 Winter Olympics will go on, with China front and center on the world stage.
They are extremely conscious and extremely proud that Beijing is about to become the first city in the world to host both summer and winter Olympics. And if the 2008 Games were the so-called coming out party for a more modern, muscular, independent and capable China, the 2022 Games, according to the Chinese watchers who I talk to, are really about them saying, we don't actually need to come out anymore, so to speak. And so today, the Olympics is a real tentpole moment for Beijing and for the Communist Party that they believe is incredibly important to have successful.
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Tim McPhillips.